Okay, it's Monday, December 14th at midnight, so the incision wasn't as big as I thought either, and it looks like they went over my belly button almost, and I thought they were going to go horizontal, like horizontal, but they went vertical like that. One thing that's interesting here, understandably, they have to do their job and make sure I'm not dead, but they are checking all the time.
Hola.
Hola.
Every 3 hours, they say, to make sure that my vital signs are okay and everything else is good. So the nurse is here at midnight, and we'll see what happens. Okay, so I am doing a more or less video log of what's happening as far as this kidney injury is concerned. I read that this is a good thing to be able to do. So first thing is the surgery is gonna be in Mexico. So as far as a psychological standpoint is concerned, that does play with me a little bit. I've lived in Colombia for about a year. Ironically, I didn't learn a ton of Spanish because while I was there, I was working online.
Yo ir, no, yo fue, visité, visitaste, magnificante, sí, visitiste, visitaste.
I did pick up a good amount though, so I'll be able to communicate, but there's still that comfort factor, right? When you're stressed and you're hearing a different language, you just want to be able to not have to think about what are they saying, because yeah, you just want to know what's going on. I don't want to think about translating and then doing it. I just want to understand what they're saying and be able to respond to it. But with that being said, that's where the recipient is. That's where the finances are going to be easiest on them. The surgery should be happening in about 5 days or so. I've been under anesthesia before, so I'm not really worried about that. Obviously, this is a bigger deal as far as giving some part of my body that performs a vital function. I don't have any fear at all as far as, you know, if something goes wrong or fear of death, anything like that.
Sunrise in Guadalajara.
One thing that I have tried to prepare myself with is getting as good shape as I can.
This is about a 2 mile run, and sunrise is about 7 a.m. right now. Just beautiful.
That's been something that I've been doing, is trying to prepare my body as much physically as possible. I also had to get a COVID test, and it's negative, thankfully. And the biggest reason why this is easy for me is because of the why behind it.
Guadalajara, like many major cities of the world, faces the problems of poverty and the delinquency of parents, leaving many children helpless, abandoned, and in need of a home. Seeing the need 15 years ago, missionaries Robert and Joy Murillo began the Annabelle Home as a place of refuge where abandoned children could be cherished, nurtured, fed, clothed, schooled, and loved. Since 1999, the Murillos have seen almost 300 children rescued, restored, and rejoicing.
I am Robert Murillo, the founder and president of the Annabelle Homes. There was a fatal vehicle accident where three ladies lost their mother, and we decided that we would take care of them. And we started the Annabelle Homes in 1999.
We get calls every week begging us to take in more children.
Take the children off of the streets, take them where they're abandoned, and put them in a home that they're loved. Would you be willing to help us help them get them off the streets and feel loved?
So my uncle, he runs an orphanage with his wife, and he's just a good man. Like when you hear some of these kids' stories, like, you know, their parents beat their brother to death in front of them, and or their sister to death, and or some kids were just hanged, like literally tied to a tree, chained, and left to die. And, you know, just rescuing the people that somehow society looks over.
So here's the lake, and this is where the orphanage is.
kids' faces, you see just this light and love with them. And I believe in that vision. And so because of that, it makes it like feel like I'm serving the vision. And obviously, I love my uncle and I want him to be able to live a long, healthy life with his family. Beyond that, like the vision that he serves is something that I just truly believe in. And it's as much for the vision as it is for him.
The pastor is Robert Murillo and missionary Robert Murillo, and he's passing out the vitamins, the Nutrilite Amway vitamins donated by Jeff Rose.
Very good flavor.
You like that one?
Robert Murillo is the youngest of us five siblings, so he's my younger brother. It was always nice to have another sibling, and that made it two boys and three girls in our family. He was about 2 years old and he got very ill, and I can remember it distinctively. It was at Christmas time because we had a Christmas tree up, and I remember the doctor coming to the house. And we found out that he had some kidney issues. The chances for his life was not very high, and it was 50-50 chances for him to live. And my dad said, nope, that's not high enough chances for me. He picked him up, took him out of the hospital, and took him to a different hospital. Even though the doctors in Chicago did not want him to leave that hospital, they said, he can't do that. And he said, oh no, yes I can. I'm going to give my son as much chance as he possibly can. He had to go to the hospital, and ever since he was 2 years old, he's had a lot of sicknesses.
I'm feeling like I'm giving up this kidney and putting it into a toxic environment, and I'm creating a story of this kidney. This it's not an inanimate object, but it doesn't have feeling or emotion, but I do, right? So I'm putting myself in this kidney, and it makes me feel like sad and tenderness. And there's things that came up that I'm learning that I have to deal with directly. And so being able to talk with people and journal, especially journal, and cry things out and allow myself to heal has been a very, very big help as well on this journey.
When Bobby was a teenager and we lived in East Chicago, Indiana, he was walking with a friend and some teenage girls that came up to him and asked him a question, and they asked him if he knew if he died today that he would go to heaven. And he was kind of giggly and everything, because here he's got these teenage girls coming and asking him and his friend some questions, and yet he wanted to know the answer to what they had to ask him. And they took him down the Romans Road, and once he heard the gospel through the Romans Road scripture, he then and there accepted Christ as his Savior, and he had decided that he wanted to follow the Lord in his life. And then once he got older and got involved in the church, he had decided that he was going to become a missionary. He wanted to go to Mexico, and out of the five siblings, he's the only one that didn't take Spanish in high school. He took Latin.
On this road, I've had to go back and forth between Mexico two or three times.
I just got done taking my blood, so I have a tuberculosis test here, and then got my blood drawn here for a bunch of tests, and now we're gonna go get some breakfast here.
Yeah, this is huevos rancheros.
Huevos rancheros, and I don't know what I got, I forgot.
Because it was supposed to happen 2 years ago, then we potentially were gonna have a stem cell type of surgery. That was gonna be in Chicago, where I'm from.
They were trying to be accepted into a program that was happening in the United States, but they did not qualify for that.
And then it turned out my uncle had hepatitis, so he couldn't do the Chicago one, so he got disqualified for that. So now it's back in Mexico.
Since my brother was lived there for almost 40 years in Mexico, he was comfortable there. And then Stephen agreed that he would go to Mexico and have this operation done there as well.
So there's been a lot of an emotional roller coaster as far as start, stop, get tested, not get tested. And that kind of wears on me emotionally and mentally, where if there's like a single date that I could look forward to, I was like, okay, I can mentally prepare for that.
We have lamb and arachera and some other stuff, but this restaurant's cool. And there's a fountain over here, that fountain right there. Every morning they give fresh roses, so every morning the flowers are fresh. So that's a good place.
Surgery was supposed to happen today, and it got delayed for whatever reason the first time. They said you should come in on the 7th of December to do your prep work. You'll have to spend the night in the hospital, and then in the morning of the 8th, they should be able to take you. Well, now there's another delay that is outside of the doctor's hands, where there's some legal entity that oversees all the things that happen in the hospital. And because I have a different last name than my uncle's last name is Murillo, and my last name is Rose, and they don't have a way to prove that my mom is a sister to my uncle. Because in Mexico, most cases, the women don't change their last name when they get married. But in this case, my mom just took the last name like most people do in the States. And so now they don't want to do the surgery unless they can prove the bloodline. So even though we've done all the blood tests, everything else that shows complete compatibility, that's good enough for the doctors, but that's not good enough for the legal team, because they want to prevent things from like organ harvesting and illegal, you know, things happening, and that's totally understandable. And so now we're having my dad scramble in the U.S. to go try to find an old marriage certificate from way back in the day to be able to show my mom's last name on a piece of paper. So that's just a big frustrating thing. So we were supposed to do it in January of 2019, and then it didn't happen. And now, you know, we're to December 2020, and it was supposed to happen December 7, 2020, and then now it's December 8th, 2020, and now it might be December 9th, or we don't know. And so it definitely, it creates a lot of emotional tug on me, because I wanna be home with my wife.
Steve and I met in Medellin, Colombia. That's where I'm from originally. And yes, that's where we met. We had a great connection. And after some time, some dates, we started a long distance relationship because he had to move back to the US.
And a year and a half after that, we got married. One day before my husband and I got married, he called me on the phone and told me, "Amor, my uncle Bobby needs a kidney transplant and I want to be the donor." And the reason why he wanted to be the donor was because he believed that the type of work that Bobby was doing was very hard to replace. He felt like if he donated his kidney to him, Bobby was going to be able to live many more years, and in that way he could keep being a blessing for others.
I want to be able to be there with her, and because she's a Colombian citizen, you know, coming to Mexico is a little bit different than her entering the U.S. because it's different government entities, especially during time of COVID, so she hasn't been able to join me during this time, which that's a big motivator for me to get back home, and I mainly want to get back before Christmas. That's my main thing. So we got, there's been 4 calls from the doctor so far, and basically they are okay with proving that my mom is the sister of my uncle. Now the next holdup is that because it's COVID time and there's a resurgency, everything has to go through a national approval. They said they're gonna try to get this approved tomorrow morning. And hypothetically, if it gets approved tomorrow morning, then it could happen tomorrow night. My emotions have been going like everywhere. It's been mostly anger. And again, it's not my uncle and aunt's fault. I don't even honestly blame the hospital. I think that this is just a very unique time in the world right now. And it's a very unique situation. I understand being COVID time plus being me being an American and him being a Mexican national. So it's been a very interesting journey.
Nos vamos a México, la capital y el estado más poblado del país anunciaron medidas extraordinarias para atajar la ola de contagios y muertes por coronavirus. Ambas regresarán al semáforo rojo, alerta de máximo contagio, mientras sus hospitales y los servicios funerarios padecen una sobresaturación.
I want to thank everyone for their prayers for my transplant. Let me tell you what's going on. We were supposed to have the transplant on Monday, but there's an organization here in Mexico that oversees all the transplants, and they see a little bit fishy that an American has another American come down to Mexico for a transplant. And so they're really looking over the paperwork, and they have not given my doctor the approval for the surgery. So please pray that they would give the green light. And I want to thank you for all your notes and your love and your prayers, and may God bless you.
We gave them all the paperwork that they needed, gave them blood samples proving that I'm blood relative to my uncle, gave them my birth certificate to prove who I am, gave them just basically lots and lots of information. So they have everything they need, and they're just trying to be extra cautious, and they have questions as far as legalities are concerned, but people don't really know who to go to get these questions answered, because this is an unusual situation that I'm an American citizen that's doing this in Mexico to a Mexican national. So because of that, there's just been another delay. The surgery still might be today. It might be this evening, but then if it goes into this evening, then the surgery team's gonna go home, and then it could be in the morning. But then again, if we don't get an answer today, then we still don't know. So yeah, I'm frustrated again. I don't want to say I'm getting used to this, but it doesn't surprise me, because this is kind of like, okay, well, more of the same. As long as I get to fly back by the 18th, then I'm good. And if all of this ends up getting moved to the US, I'd feel way more comfortable too. I'm in an Uber now, and basically they want me to come into the office physically to get a signature. I think it's just gonna be basically, I'm not gonna sue them if something goes wrong. I'm guessing that's what they're doing, but I have to go in there with my passport and my ID to sign this. So it still could be today, could be tomorrow, we'll see. So when I went to the doctor's place to give consent on the kidney, they said they're gonna give a call today at 8 p.m. They just got a call saying, we don't know. And give us a call at 9 a.m. tomorrow. Yeah. For this trip specifically, 1, 2, like the 4th delay or something like that, 4th or 5th. So, I'm f***ing angry. And on top of that too, there's 8 of us in the house right now. I feel like I've been literally just kind of stuck in this. It's either between here or the hospital. They said don't eat breakfast, which means it could be tomorrow again. So another day of fasting because I might have surgery. And so, yeah, I've been hungry. I'm tired and emotionally stressed. I miss Ellie a lot. I'm just going through a lot as far as emotional, and I can't process it. That's the biggest thing, is I don't have my own personal space to process this stuff. That's probably the hardest part. Okay, December 9th, 2020, 9 a.m. They told us to call at 9 a.m. Then they told us to call back in a half hour. At 9:30, they said, we still don't know. And
Yeah.
They told me not to eat any breakfast at first, and then on this most recent call, they said go ahead and eat breakfast for now. And so that means because I can't fast, I can't eat for at least 8 hours before the surgeries, that the most possible recent would be sometime around 5 today, something like that. It's been hard to be able to give my wife these updates.
The process of Steve donating his kidney to Bobby was a very long one.
Steven, bear in mind, he said that he was going to donate his kidney. It was 3 years prior to the actual operation, and he didn't even know his present wife, Eliana. He met her during this time when, after he already committed that he would donate his kidney. So then once he was dating her and got engaged, he wanted to, he also made sure that she was okay with him donating the kidney, and she said yes. So bless her heart, she was okay with it, and of course concerned about it.
It also impacted our relationship in some way. For example, when we got married and we were planning on having our honeymoon, we almost canceled the honeymoon because then they said the surgery was supposed to happen during that date, and then it got canceled. So we felt all the anxiety and frustration of all those previous times. So
his life was kind of on standstill for quite a while there. And he did, for a young man, gave up a lot of his time and effort and emotion.
You know, her being away, and then we're getting closer and closer to like the 7 day mark. So I guess I shouldn't be flying within 7 days because I'm gonna have stitches. And they said I get the stitches out in day 7. And I really, really wanna be back by the 18th because that's when my flight is back. Hola, amor. So the doctors just called, and now they said they want me to go get a notary for signing an official document that I'm Stephen Rose, and that they're not paying me for this, or they're not harvesting or anything like that. So now they want me to go to the notary, and the first notary that we were going to go to has COVID, so now we're finding a different notary. Interesting scenario. So we found a notary that can do the thing today, and the doctor at the hospital said if we get that notary to them in person, in hand, then they might be able to do it or might not. So my dear sweet mother, who I won't show because she's always scared of camera, or can I show you?
And because Ileana is from the country of Colombia, it was not really a good idea for her to go to Mexico because she was still working on her visa to stay in America. So I got to go to Mexico to be his Stephen's support.
She has been a trooper in all this, and doing everything she could to be able to doing everything she could to be able to stay sane, and because she's been going through all these updates too. So
Stephen is my youngest child. I have 2 sons, Jeffrey and Stephen, and they are 9 years apart, and he's the youngest of the two. Stephen was a fun-loving child. He was a person that was always a giving person, and when he heard that his uncle Robert had this need of a kidney, he thought he would go ahead and check and see if he could be a match. And he was a match. Very healthy young man. He decided on his own that he was going to be the donor for his uncle, and not only for his life, but I knew that he believed in the ministry that he was serving in for the Lord, and that he knew that there were orphans there, children in the children's home, and they needed to keep their father, so to speak, healthy and keep the ministry going.
And we got the notary with the lawyer thing done. Went, talked to the doctor. The doctor said, uncle has to go back in for a dialysis tomorrow, and he still doesn't know when the surgery's gonna be. So yeah, tomorrow will be Thursday. We're supposed to have it on Monday, and now tomorrow's Thursday. So I'm tired. I had to fast all day today. I only had breakfast, and then now I have to fast again in the morning. So
Stephen and Robert had to fast for the morning, and then getting ready for the operation, and then they would call and say, "No, well, it'll be about 4 o'clock." Then they'd not eat up to 4 o'clock, and then they say, "Well, no, it's going to be in the morning." But then you couldn't eat past a certain time, and then it was brutal.
Yeah, it's just basically been days on days of fasting, and then emotional roller coaster of it's going to happen, and then that time comes and goes. So it's just emotionally draining. Last night, the doctor said, "Hey, thanks for getting us that sheet of paper. Call us Thursday morning today at 9 a.m. They said that for the past 3 days. He also said he's 98% sure that it'll happen today. I think he was also 100% sure that it was supposed to happen on Monday.
There was a point where Stephen felt very frustrated.
There's a few different factors around like my discomfort. This is around Christmas time. I want to get back with my wife. I don't want to be here any longer than I have to anymore because of this experience that's just left a bad taste in my mouth. Two, I'm hungry all the time.
He started to lose weight. He looked very tired.
Just not being able to sleep that well. There's a lot of anxiousness and energy I have built up that usually I would work out with and feel better. It doesn't feel that way right now.
He was holding all that on his chest, and I also started to feel worried about him.
Another thing that doesn't feel good is the fact that I want to be able to do these types of videos, but I just haven't had my own real space.
Some other things, there's my mom. If I have to, we have to book another hotel because I'd rather be in a hotel, and no, thank you. We have to,
when sharing a room with my mom, and there's 8 people and 4 dogs in the house.
Stephen and I, we were staying with Joy and Bobby and his family, and then we had planned on staying in a hotel for his recuperation. Well, since the surgery didn't happen and we already paid for the hotel, we decided to go ahead and stay at the hotel.
I understand that emotions can make me think things that aren't necessarily true. I'm just trying to find reasons why I feel a certain way. I want to make like this rash decision. Let's get this over with. Then the other half of me is like, no, the longer I'm with 2 kidneys, I'm in a healthy place right now.
I'm not thinking as rational. I don't want to do this in Mexico anymore. His life would suck without me doing this, but he can go on with dialysis. If he doesn't get this, his body will shut down and is shutting down. He's closer and closer every day to essentially dying. My comfort and my desires directly conflict with another man's life.
In those days when there were so many delays and I started to see Steve suffering day after day, physically, emotionally, and mentally, I started to feel anxious. I tried to hide that from him, and you know, I wasn't even able to be there in Mexico with him. But yeah, when there was this point where he exploded, then I started feeling a little anxiety in my chest. And I told him too, well, maybe this is not meant to happen. We said, okay, let's stop this then. Let's talk with Bob and Joy, and let's tell them that the surgery is not happening anymore.
Joy and Robert came to the hotel room, and Eliana was on a Zoom video type thing so that they could see her and she can also be in the discussion.
Started on this about 2 years ago when my uncle said that he was in need of a transplant, and I was like, well, maybe if nobody volunteers in the family, it will. And I have O negative blood type, which is a universal donor, and so I offered to.
But then once it happened, the stem cell thing came out, and then they found out he has a dormant stage of hepatitis, which could have killed the kidney if the original transplant had taken place, but it also disqualified him for the second round of stem cell transplant. Well, around the stem cell time is when I met Ellie.
I started to feel a lot of fear because I didn't want anything bad to happen to my husband. I started to fear that if the people in the hospital were there, were not able to handle something as simple as paperwork, and it wasn't during that week that Steve was there, but during 2 years.
Had made decisions around my marriage based off of the possibility of a surgery. Made decisions off of moving, like based off of what if I get a surgery, and this is in Colombia, and this is my fault for not prioritizing this. I've always looked at this as Ellie inherited this and she's been okay, but we've never had a couple-to-couple conversation about this, and so there has to be some sort of closure around this in my life. Like there have been major, major decisions around circling around somebody else's problem, and so I can't make that a priority as much as it was anymore.
It was almost for a full week that the people from the hospital kept delaying it.
I don't view this as like, okay, it hasn't happened within 5 days of me being here, I'm not doing it anymore. I view it because it hasn't happened with 2 years and 5 days, I don't feel comfortable doing this anymore.
It didn't make sense in my head, and I started to have a lot of fear, and I didn't want Steve to be suffering indefinitely.
Yeah, I guess when I look from the outside in, like, I don't want to serve my uncle so bad, and I want to take away the difficulty he has. I don't want there to be a strained relationship or anything like that. Priorities I have around life have changed, and I feel like there has to be a hard deadline.
Of course, it was very shocking for Bobby and Joy. They told us, especially Joy told us, please don't do this.
Joy was very wanting to get this taken care of because this is her husband, and wanting to make sure that it got to work, and Bobby was very calm and very concerned with Steven's concerns, and very putting others first as well.
We need a yes to be yes and no to be no, and right now, yes isn't yes. Yes is maybe, and then maybe is later, and then later and later. And so, and if this is God telling us, like, no, I don't want to fight against that. Because at the end of the day, if we force this, something bad will happen to one of us.
And she told us, well, give us one more day. One more day and this surgery is going to happen.
If it didn't happen by the next day, then Stephen was not going to donate the kidney and we were just going to back out.
We had that agreement with them. We said, like, okay, one more day. But if it doesn't happen tomorrow, then Steve will come back home. Then the next day, their son called somebody.
Caleb called the Secretary of State of Mexico and was able to convince them that we were not a family that were trying to take a kidney that did not belong to them, and that Stephen truly was his nephew, and that Stephen truly was my son, and that Robert really was my blood brother, and that we were all family. So when Caleb got into the picture and got in touch with the Secretary of State and said that we were legitimate and that we were family, and then it was all of a sudden, it was a go, and the doors opened, and we were able to go in to get to the hospital and get this done.
I want to thank you for praying for me. Now I'll be going to my transplant in just a few minutes. Thank you for your prayers.
Dios, gracias por este día. Gracias que podemos vivir en un tiempo cuando yo puedo dar algo así a mi tío y él puede vivir más años y yo soy totalmente saludable y él también. So, gracias por esa tecnología, gracias por ese progreso en médico. Sí, y gracias para los médicos y por favor poner su mano sobre este día en las dos operaciones. En nombre de Jesucristo, amén.
I have two entry points right here. Este es para el robótico, sí. And so they could make it bigger, and then this is the entry point where they took it out. Yeah, so they could take out the kidney. And it was the left kidney they took out.
The left kidney.
The most uncomfortable thing right now is I feel like I have to take the world's largest dump, but it's just because they inflated my stomach with gas.
Por eso sientes la presión.
Sí, sí, sí.
Pero ese aire se va a absorber.
Sí.
Tú sientes duro.
Sí. Mm-hmm.
Es normal.
Okay.
¿Eh? Sí. Más hay que estarte vigilando. ¿Eh? Okay. ¿De acuerdo? Okay. Todo bien, ¿eh?
Gracias, doctor.
Okay.
What's something interesting that I've just noticed is I just was able to start drinking my first sips of water. So they took my left kidney. I could feel it wanting to go into that left kidney, but like it's tender there. It's not like it hurts, and then like it just bypasses it, and I could actually feel it going to my right one. So it's weird how I could physically notice my kidneys right now.
The operation was a success. It really was, and it was so good that it was. And I'm so grateful that Stephen is able to live a healthy life.
God's good. Lord willing, I'll be able to get back to Dallas in 6 days with Ellie.
Just thinking like how grateful I am for my wife. She wasn't able to be here, and we made that decision for some specific reasons, but she's been able to hold down the fort there, and without her, this would have been just such a tough experience.
I think that since Steve told me that he wanted to be the donor of the kidney, I felt afraid and nervous, but during the whole time I tried to be very supportive with him.
It's been a huge blessing with her making that sacrifice of not being here, which I know I would absolutely want to be here.
He loves serving people, helping others. He's always making new friends. He's such a great person, and I'm so lucky to have him as my husband.
We're going to visit Bobby now.
Gracias. Everybody here?
Yeah, we're here.
It's, you know, it's all 62 years old.
Yeah. And I'm sure these younger people had transplants and I think everybody in
Yeah. Well, they're sissies though. Your Uncle Bobby, yeah. you find them with it. You feel a difference?
I feel all spunky.
Oh, that's good.
Happy, so, yeah, I feel good.
I'm healthy, my uncle's healthy, he's already starting to pee, which is a function that he was starting to lose with his own two normal kidneys. And so that means the kidney is immediately working and starting to filter out his body from all the poisons.
I want to thank you for your prayers. I believe because of your prayers, I'm having a wonderful recovery. The doctors are just amazed at the recovery. Thank you so much for your prayers. God bless you.
Thank you.
this is Missionary Robert Morello. I want to thank all the people that, prayed for me during the transplant. I finally made it home. New kidney is working very well. And I thank you for all that you prayed for me and all your thoughts and your considerations.
Missionary Robert Morello joined his loving Savior, Jesus Christ, while on the mission field at Guadalajara, Mexico. Robert has been introducing his Savior to many souls since he was a teenager, when he accepted Jesus Christ as his own personal Savior. Robert shared Christ's love wherever and whenever to whomever would listen, and had been a missionary for over 40 years. Robert passed into eternity on Wednesday, April 14th, 2021, in Guadalajara, Mexico. After a successful kidney transplant, he was taken by a virus that eventually damaged his lungs and caused cardiac arrest.
Bobby has done a lot of good in regards to serving others, spreading the gospel, sharing his life with the Mexican people out in Guadalajara.
To love others in a selfless way. This is what Bobby did during his life. He spent his time, his resources, part of his money in order to help people and these children in need.
I don't understand what the good Lord did and why, but I trust Him. I trust God. I know He has a plan. It's been difficult, but we will go forward. And I'm so proud of my Stephen, what he was willing to give up so that others and God's ministry can continue, and it will. So it was not for nothing that he gave his kidney. He gave it for those kids, and he gave it to my brother, and I'm very proud of my son.
I want to wrap this video up by going back to the beginning. Bobby was born in a Mexican-American household that didn't have money. As young as the five kids, by the time he was around 8 or 9 years old, he had to wear a catheter full time, and sometimes the urine bag that he had to wear would leak and his clothes would smell bad and kids would bully him. When he was around 17, 18 years old, weighed about 75 pounds or 32 kilograms. And one day when Bobby was walking on the sidewalk, some girls approached him and asked him if he was gonna go to heaven when he died. Now, I'm not gonna get into that whole journey, but Bobby's life changed that day when he became a Christian. And Bobby was able to reach a lot of people because the circumstances that made him a victim no longer made him a victim, but they empowered him to reach people in a deeper level than most people ever possibly can. Bobby, when he approached people, he didn't have a good way with words. He had his own urine bag that he had to carry around. He was sickly, But people simply saw that this man was reaching out from the deepest parts of him, and he had love for them. Despite the church that he went to, some people not agreeing with the message, maybe some people not agreeing with Christianity in general, they saw that my uncle cared for them. And that's the reason why he was able to bless so many people. He was able to help literally thousands and thousands and thousands of people because he was serving people from all walks of life from a place of authenticity. This journey didn't end up the way I thought it was going to, where my uncle passed away, but his legacy lives on. And he taught me a very valuable gift that I hope to pass on to you. Give without strings attached. I was able to give this kidney and have my uncle pass away with total peace in my heart, because no matter what happened, there's no strings attached. I felt like my uncle can reach far more people with my kidney than I could with my own kidney. And again, despite circumstances changing, we can still use these circumstances to reach more people. And I want to invite you to live a life that gives in such a way where you're not expecting anything back from anybody else. Perhaps that looks like volunteering at your local homeless shelter. Perhaps it looks like giving to a local church. And maybe if you have no faith at all, that's okay. Give of your talents, give of your blessings, give of your abundance. When the world is a place that is bigger than you, it becomes a very satisfying place to live. So with that being said, I want to leave you with the blessing of one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It's from the book of Numbers, chapter 6, 24 through 26. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and his peace. God bless you. God bless your family. And be well.
Sometimes a journey is unexpected. Sometimes it's hard to find. One servant's journey to consider began in 1999. A preacher man, the humble type, who served God faithfully, came to a pass, a turning point, because of crisis, you will see. This man of God, he took his church to a gathering of the Lord, but upon their return from that place, God shut and opened doors. There were two groups that traveled there, but only one would return unscathed. At that point, it was impossible to see the road the Lord had paved. The preacher had a young assistant. He too was a faithful soul, but the accident that occurred that day, it took a heavy toll. Three sweet ladies left this world. From death, they could not hide. The young assistant's friend, as well as his mother, and finally, his brand new bride. They all were gone in a moment's notice. God took them in his hand. But as one door shut, another opened, and the preacher's journey began. The accident that took place that day left three girls without a place to go. In the midst of all the aftermath, an idea began to grow. At first, it began as temporary. Immediate needs had to be met. God hadn't shown the pastor everything. He hadn't revealed all just yet. The preacher man and his wife, they took it day by day. They comforted the young assistant and gave those three girls a place to stay. The days turned to weeks and weeks to months. God spoke to the preacher man. He said, "This isn't temporary. This has always been my plan. As for your assistant, he'll be blessed and bless others too. And as for the young ladies, your responsibilities are not through. Continue to listen and obey to everything I tell. You'll open up an orphanage and name it Annabelle. But this won't be any orphanage. I want you to turn it into a home because I'm a father to the fatherless. These children won't be alone. You are to give them family structure, a father and a mother. I want them to be loved as well as love one another. These children are not forgotten. I will send you many more. I know the road is difficult, but I will open all the doors." The preacher man stepped out in faith. He told his wife God's word. She looked at him thoughtfully.
and considered what she'd heard. They got to work, but so did God. He began to open doors. As he provided, the rest came true, and then came more and more. The young assistant never lost hope, nor doubted God from what occurred. And now he's blessed, just as God said, and is preaching the holy word. And through this ministry, many have been blessed. The number, I can't exactly tell. But all this journey began the day the world lost Annabelle. Mothers and fathers have come to help, and children have found a home, because God is father to the fatherless and did not leave them alone. This journey is not over. It goes on, you understand. When Annabelle entered heaven, the journey truly began. The preacher man continued on. He obeyed all that God said. God looked upon the preacher man and said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant."